Hey guys, Professor Bill, Comic Book University. Welcome to podcast number 14. Guys, couple things I want to talk about. Technically a few. Couple is two. Few is three. Anyway, I want to talk about how worthy or unworthy Thor is. I want to talk about Power Rangers, because that movie should have come out yesterday by the time that you see this, today when I'm recording it. And I want to do something strange. I want to do a comparison between Batman vs. Superman and the Netflix release of Iron Fist. And I'm going to say, get this, good things about Batman vs. Superman. I know. Me? Yeah, me. Okay, because I don't entirely hate it. I tend to usually focus on the bad things first and then talk about the good things. And everybody usually turns off by the time that they start hearing the bad things. Don't even listen for the good things. So, hey, your choice. But anyway, so let's get started. I want to talk about Thor. Now, The Unworthy Thor has been a monthly series, okay, in this day and age where it seems like all the good stuff is biweekly. This is a monthly series, or it was, and issue number 5 just came out, and I do believe that that's it. Done. We're done. We're not going to have a Unworthy Thor issue number 6, at least not in this first volume. So whether it gets revisited or not is not up to me. But this is the issue. It was called The Whisper. And in this issue, we get several things. Did Thor actually pick up that hammer from the Earth 1610, the Ultimate Universe, or did he not? And the answer is he did not. He chose not to. He actually chose not to. It was an interesting bait and switch, okay? It was kind of like, you know, we started thinking, okay, either because he was right at it, he was just about to lift it, and then issue 4 ended. And then issue 5, it's like we're speculating for a month. Okay, is he worthy enough to lift this hammer, or is he not worthy enough to lift this hammer? And we kept on thinking, yes or no, right? And they totally bait and switched us and said, oh, he's not even going to lift it. Yeah, noobs, gotcha. We got trolled. We got trolled. I am not happy with spending money to get trolled. You know what I'm saying? It's one thing if you're sitting there and you're watching a video and, you know, the clickbait, and it's a free video, and all of a sudden, you know, it's like Rick Ashley comes on. You know what I'm saying? You got Rick rolled. Or if you're sitting there watching and all of a sudden, John Cena. I love those. I love both of them. They're both good. But I'm not paying for that. When I go out and I pay money and I get Rick rolled, all right? I'm not cool. I don't want to, you know, be like, oh, here it is. We're going to finally find out. And I opened up the page and there's Rick Ashley giving me the middle finger with John Cena getting, you know, RKO'd out of nowhere. That's not cool, man. That's not cool. So they did, however, make it up in the sense that two things. One, minor, there's going to be a new Thor. Now, it's been speculated that this might be the Thor from the Earth 1610 universe, the ultimate Thor, Thor Leaf, but he died. He died. Maybe he's back, but he died 2-3 years ago. Yeah, he's gone. He's history. So, no, likely not. Actually, I think it was a year ago. Anyway, what we do have, however, is a new Thor. I'm kind of hoping, I'm rooting for Eric Masterson. We'll see. He took over for Thor back in the mid-90s, early to mid-90s. And I actually kind of liked him. He eventually became Thunderstrike. He wound up getting a mace instead of a hammer. Very cool. He was good as Thor. As Thunderstrike, the comic, they didn't have such good writers on it. And eventually not good artists either. It is what it is. And what happened? We also wound up finding out what Nick Fury said to Thor, which was very interesting to say the least. He whispered in his ear, way back in the day, Gore was right. That's it. Three little words made him unworthy. Because that indicates, and this is actually a pretty big deal, you know, when all things come to a head. Gore was the God Butcherer. He was part of the Volume 3, I think it was, of Thor. And it was intense. Like, here's this guy, this god who butchered other gods. And he was really only powerful when he was in connection with the sword that he had. This weapon was of immense power. And once he was separated from it, which is actually a really good, like, a lot of guys who, even though you love the story, maybe some people didn't get the innuendo that was in there. Originally, when Thor was in the comics, written by Stan Lee and drawn by Jack Kirby, and plotted oftentimes by Jack Kirby also, is the idea that if Thor was away from his hammer for more than a minute, then he would turn back into Donald Blake. So with the God Butcher having the exact same thing, that was sick. That was sick. You know, really beautiful throwback. So maybe if he comes back, then he won't have that weakness anymore. That would be very interesting. And then how do you stop him? You know, how do you stop this cat? With the Thor core, of course. Maybe that's why they need an extra Thor. Yeah. So it won't be nearly as numerous as the Green Lantern core, but yeah, on par in power without doubt. So, especially with Jane Foster. But yeah, it was very interesting because Gore's big thing he said to Thor was that you are not worthy. None of the gods, none of you gods, and not just you Asgardian gods. I'm talking all of the Greek gods, including Hercules and Zeus, probably especially Zeus. What a jerk that guy is. The Shi'ar gods, and I mentioned this in my review, my comic book review of Thor, the Unworthy Thor number 5, but a little bit of a reiteration and a couple of new points. The idea that you look back in the Mighty Thor issues with Jane Foster currently going on right now, she's battling the Shi'ar gods, and it was kind of a contest to see who's greater. And the Shi'ar gods, they would do things like, you know, to prove godliness, okay? They would go to their own home planet, one of them, the center, and they would summon a tidal wave onto a beach that would just obliterate everyone. And they're laughing, these two prime Shi'ar gods. They're laughing, and they're more powerful than Thor. You know, throwing her around like she's a chump, like she's a rag doll. Beating her up, and then they go and do this. And they say, yeah, that's right. We're going to wind up killing about 1 million people. But the other hundreds of millions of people, billions of people on this planet and in the entire star system will start praying to us even more. Because that's what these mortals do. Wow, talk about social commentary. Thor, for her part, she flies straight into it, risking great, you know, danger to herself, and she tries to rescue as many of these people as possible and tries to summon the winds to send back the tidal wave, you know, and to break it, and saves all these people. And she did it in person, so people saw her, and all of a sudden, her worship, they forgot about their own unseen gods who are constantly doing these bad things, and they actually saw a hero directly, and they're like, hey, isn't that Thor from the mythologies? Yeah, of course that's Thor. Everyone knows Thor. All hail Thor. And they start worshiping her, and all of a sudden, and some of it wasn't even just worship, maybe it's like hero worship, whatever, but, you know, semantics aside, they gave her favor, and she won that particular contest. Kind of pissed off the Shi'ar gods in a pretty major way. But, you know, like stuff like that, like when you see things like that, yeah, Gore was right. I mean, that's gorgeous storytelling. That's amazing writing, you know? I really loved the Unworthy Thor series, all 5 issues, okay? The issue itself kind of left a little to be desired because of the whole, you know, I'm not going to pick up this hammer. I'm going to leave for somebody else. It's not my hammer. It does show the honor of Thor. We didn't know it was an option that's necessarily on the table, whatever. But the final reveal, I think that it was worth it, you know, because let's face it, nothing was going to live up to the fans' minds. What did Nick Fury say? You know, say he had some kind of secret word and Thor. Ooh, Thor is really Ragnarok. You know, imagine that. If Thor's really his own clone, you know, a cyborg enhanced clone, Ragnarok. And he whispered the access code in his ear, you know what I'm saying? Nick's data 5. And all of a sudden, you know, now I'm, you know, programmed to be unworthy to pick up Mjolnir. That would have been interesting, to say the least, you know what I'm saying? And a couple other theories that were out there. But, this was good enough. This was good enough. And it makes Gore relevant again. And I know a few people outside of myself who would be all sorts of happy to see Gore return. And genuinely, I'm hoping for it. Guys, moving on. Power Rangers. Okay. Haim Saban, sorry, I never met him to ask him. He has come out publicly saying that the fans of today are more sophisticated than they were back in the day. Okay. Now look, the first time I ever heard of the Power Rangers, I was out of my basic training and all that stuff in the army. and I started taking college courses, okay, for the first time. And in my first semester of taking college, I was actually at a community college because I didn't know what the heck I wanted to do, to be honest. You know, I was an infantry soldier. Like, what do? Come out and be a cop? You know what I'm saying? Not really. You're not supposed to go out and shoot people as a cop. More on that, hopefully never. But anyway, so the idea is that I went and I just started doing what I do, which is being creative. I took all of my basic math classes, you know, that I needed to take and whatnot, and things that I didn't take in high school that I probably should have. Oops. Horrible guidance counselor. And then I took a creative writing class, you know, because I always wanted to be a comic book writer and a comic book, you know, artist. That's what I always wanted to do when I was younger. And who knows? We'll see. But I got into electrical engineering instead by, you know, looking at how deficient I felt that, you know, the country was in regards to people who actually understood math, and started seeing some of the other things that were available and marketing myself that way. But either way, this creative writing class, there was a guy in there who he was special needs. You know what I'm saying? Told me a lot about the class I was in, but he was special needs, and he would ever talk about were the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. I had no idea who these things were. So finally I was like, you know what? This guy, all he ever does is talk about this stuff. You know what? I'm going to go and see what the hype is. And a lot of us did that, right? Because he was a very endearing guy, very cool guy, you know what I'm saying? And just, that's what he loved, the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. I remember when I finally did go out and see that, because this is, guys, this is before the internet, okay? So, yeah, imagine that, a time before the internet. So I couldn't just go and look up the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. There was no such thing as look up, okay? It was go to the library and research, you know what I'm saying? So I actually went to a video store, and I found a videotape on Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. And go figure, it was the Green with Evil five-parter. So, oh my God. You know what I'm saying? I became hooked on the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers. It was so incredible. It was intense. I'm like, this guy's a genius. So I actually drew a picture of the Red Ranger form and gave it to him. And he was just, you know, he lit up. Like, we all gave him stuff, you know what I'm saying? Because he was a cool guy. But yeah, his face, he lit up, and just forever, you know what I'm saying? He's probably still got that in his refrigerator. God bless him. But what do you call it? Yeah, I did start watching it on regular TV in syndication. I went back and I was able to find the first episode and so on, and watch the entire first season, really long season. And now it's on Netflix. So I actually rewatched Green with Evil a month or two ago. Just unbelievably good, you know, unbelievably better than it had any right to be for how cheap and campy that TV show was. Oh my God. So when Haim Saban talks about how sophisticated today's fans are compared to back in the day, yes, you'll get fans like me, all right? Fans younger than me who have that nostalgia about it, and they're going to go and see this movie anyway. But you want to keep us. You can't have that same cheesy, campy stuff with, all right, guys, let's go. Oh, Pterosaurus. And Pterosaurus is not even a real freaking animal, but whatever. Okay? All that good stuff. You know what I'm saying? Like, that, you can't really have it all cheesy, campy, goofy like that anymore. You got to make it a lot more realistic. And yeah, maybe a little bit darker. All right. Having Bryan Cranston on there is probably not such a bad idea, you know? Power Rangers, it's cooking time. I saw that meme and it's beautiful. Anyway, so that's his point. And this leads up to him releasing information that they have plans to do 6 Power Rangers movies. Now, by the time that this podcast goes live, Power Rangers is already out in theaters, and they will already be having the meeting, all right? They're going to do this on Saturday, the 25th of March, 2017, when this video comes out, that they're going to determine, are they going to make a sequel? Yeah, that soon, that quick, because they already have plans. Scripts? No, they do not have scripts for the other up to 5 movies, but they do have plans, and that's good enough. And any Dune fan knows that plans within plans is a good thing, you know, unless you're House Atreides. But the point is that, yeah, man, forget about it. If this turns out to be good, then I'm looking forward to seeing more stuff. And the spoiler that was dropped, guys, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to raise my hand And while my hand is raised, there will be a spoiler spoken, okay? When I lower my hand, the spoiler will end. So if you don't want to hear a spoiler about the Power Rangers, okay? Maybe you've already heard it, whatever. Then keep your sound off while my hand is raised. Okay, here it goes. Rita Repulsa is or has the Green Ranger helmet. Yeah, dude, that's sick, right? that was kind of cheesy, right? Anyway, so obviously that would make sense that what I was just talking about earlier would therefore be the sequel. There's no plans for that necessarily, or at least not released, okay? They haven't dropped anything like that, but according to that spoiler information, oh yeah, I'm so behind this. I'm behind this, all right? I'm so down for seeing something like this, okay? So, yes, I'm going to go and see the Power Ranger movie. Yeah, I genuinely believe it's going to be pretty darn good. I mean, with all that they've released with the trailers, I think it's going to be really, really good, all right? They got the Justice League versus Power Rangers comic book out right now. I'm so down to see some Power Rangers, you know? And if I don't see Jason David Frank, maybe I mixed it. He's got three first names. I don't know what to tell you. But if I don't see him, the original Green Power Ranger in this, I'm going to be a little bit upset. I at least want to, you know what would be cool? I would like to see that they're in there chilling out and the five original Power Rangers plus the Green White Ranger is sitting there in that restaurant, right? And I want to see Skull. And, oh God, it's been so long since I've seen the Power Rangers. Oh man. But you know what I'm talking about. Skull and the other guy. Anyways, Crunch. Anyway, I want to see those two guys sitting there also with them, you know? Just a really brief cameo. Just let the camera pan over it. You know what I'm saying? That would be beautiful. I would love to see something like that. Maybe a little bit more. Who knows? But also, don't forget, no spoilers on this, but there will be at least one after credit scene. Post credit scene. So either mid credits or after credits. All right. So no, do not go home right away once the credits start rolling. There is going to be something else there, and the hint is that it's supposed to be about that spoiler. Okay, so boom shakalaka, baby. That's what I'm talking about. I'm really looking forward to this movie. Finally, let's talk about Iron Fist. Now, the results have come out for the initial views, the first week of views for Iron Fist, and it is good. They have, now, mind you, I said views, not reviews, okay? We already know that the previews for Iron Fist, those 6 to 8 people who came out, the different companies, and said, you know, Power Rangers, I'm back there again. Iron Fist is not that good. You know, too much boardroom stuff, it falls flat, blah, 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 all this stuff. I did my reviews, and you can go back and see them on YouTube. I did my reviews of each and every individual episode of the Iron Fist. And literally, I would, at 3 a.m., I'm on East Coast time, at 3 a.m., I would go and I would look and I would see this and be like, okay, here's episode one, bang, see the whole thing. Get up, take my phone, the camera on it, go in the hallway so as to not wake my family, and I would do the review. Later on, when they're awake, I would come into my man cave, more like a man hole, and I would do my reviews. I would watch it, you know, on the computer or whatnot. So I muscled out the entire 13 episodes, right? The entire 13 episodes. Started at 3 o'clock in the morning, finished at 5 p.m., all right? Five in the afternoon. The following day, I stayed up the entire time and I was up the entire day before. I got like an hour and a half of restfulness, not necessarily sleep. So almost like laying, horizontal meditation. Anyway, and I enjoyed it. I don't think it was nearly as good as it could have been. It definitely wasn't as good as it should have been, you know, but it got a lot of bad reviews from reputable sources. Reviews that many of us think were not warranted, especially not for those particular 6 episodes. And many of us felt us leaving flat. Many of us, you know, we felt like, no, it was an incredible series. Many of us felt like, no, it absolutely stunk. You know, it is what it is. Your individual views are your own, and they're all 100% justified and valid. Absolutely. I'm not here to argue whether it was good or not. I personally thought it was passable. It was passable, but easily the weakest of everything else that Netflix and Marvel have given us so far, my opinion. And when push comes to shove, I've rewatched, I didn't rewatch Daredevil season 2 yet. I will go back and rewatch that. And I've already rewatched season 1, Jessica Jones, and Luke Cage. I do not plan on rewatching Iron Fist, just to give you an idea of how I feel about it. I genuinely don't. Like, that's a week after I've seen it now. Yeah. Yeah, I feel a little bit betrayed, you know? But it had a lot of bad press going into it. Not the very least of which to say that there was the whitewashing allegations. Now, understand what whitewashing means. The TV show was not whitewashed. Please listen. If you're upset by the fact that I just said that, you might learn something right now, okay? The TV show was not whitewashed because the original comic was a white guy. Now, the original comic was whitewashed. Okay, that's actually what we're at. Now maybe there's some people mad that I said that. You got to just understanding, it's the idea of semantics, linguistics, all right? You have to understand what the word actually means, okay? The idea of, forget about cultural appropriation. I'm not a big fan of hearing about cultural appropriation, okay? Like the whole, I don't like Miley Cyrus, okay? But the idea of her twerking, people saying, oh, she shouldn't twerk because that actually comes from Africa and it's cultural appropriation. And if you're not going to teach people about everything that has to do with Africa, I know that's a huge exaggeration, then you shouldn't do it whatsoever. Maybe it's called respecting someone else's culture or whatever and whatever. And it's just something that somebody wants to do. And there you go. Okay. The whole eeny, meeny, miny, mo thing. Okay. I never heard until this year that eeny, meeny, miny, mo actually meant something else. It wasn't catch a tiger by the toe. It was actually catch something else by the toe, which, yeah, I'm not going to say that word. Okay, it's the one word in the English language that no matter what, I'm not even going to mumble that word, you know, in an aside, not me. But yeah, and if you know me, you know, I've stopped just all white people in a room and friends, and somebody says that word, I'm like, hey, dude, not cool, not around me. So that's me. The idea is I didn't know that. So hearing about, you know, oh, you can't sing that song anymore because it originally comes from, things change, man. Things change. Originally, Ring Around the Rosie was about people dying from the Black Plague and being burnt and having their ashes spread because that was the only way to make sure that the plague didn't, you know, go around further. Right? Does that mean that we can't sing that song anymore either? We live in a free country. We live in a fairly free world, all right? And suggesting that people are not allowed, like when one person or one group tells another group or anything that you can't say something, you really have to understand that you are now officially totalitarian. Whether you have the ability to enforce it or not, that is totalitarian. Stop, check yourself. That's my suggestion. Continuing, Iron Fist, yeah, there was a lot with it. I've already given my views on why it was not a bad story from the beginning. The idea of a white guy learning martial arts and moving on, cultural appropriation or not. Sorry, I learned martial arts when I learned the Japanese martial arts when I actually first started when I was around 8, really got into a lot later when I was older, and just woof, all right? I became pretty good at it for a while. Are you suggesting that I shouldn't have learned it because I'm white? Because that would be a very foolish thing to say. So that's my opinion on that. But leaving the rest of that to the side, and I really didn't expect to get into that, but you know what? Sometimes, you know, speaking from the heart is the best way to go, all right? Now, that being the aside, when you look at Iron Fist and it wasn't really divisive, okay? I'm not going to say it was divisive, but it did have a lot of countering points, all right? For the very first time ever, Marvel fans started saying, and mind you, I'm not a Marvel fan, I'm a comic book fan, all right? But Marvel fans kind of got the BVS treatment, the Batman vs. Superman treatment, where Rotten Tomatoes gives it a score of like zero. I think it went up to 13. Who knows what it's at now? I don't actually care what it's up to now. All right. I don't actually care. All right. But yeah, not the best reviews. And now all of a sudden, Marvel fans going, screw Rotten Tomatoes, man, because blah, you know? So the critics at Rotten Tomatoes, what are you going to do? You know, what are you going to do? But it still wasn't quite as divisive as Batman vs. Superman. Now, I've got a number here, a couple of numbers, actually. I just put this up on Real Professor Bill on Facebook, so you can see all my comic book news that I put up. I actually just put this up not too long ago, that Deadline Hollywood has released Batman vs. Superman, the total gross, okay? Because when you look at it, just the box office numbers are one thing. Hey, it had at the time, it was the best box office opening ever, you know? But now something else just passed it, and who cares? Who cares? But the first week, the box office opening was incredible for Batman vs. Superman, because you got Superman, Batman, and Wonder Woman, the three most recognizable characters, probably more recognizable than Superman, than Spider-Man, you know, and Wolverine. But, yeah, I mean, you're talking about the most popular characters ever. Of course it's going to have an amazing opening weekend. People want to see this. This has never been done before. After that, sales kind of, what's the word for it? Tanked. Sales absolutely tanked, all right? I went and saw it opening weekend. I dealt with the rush and everything like that, and I should have waited a week so I could have gone to an empty movie theater. Okay, or like seriously, like the numbers dropped more, like there was a record first, you know, viewing, record drop for second week box office is what it is. And I'm pinning it. That's what I'm going to get to in a moment. But literally, like Thor the Dark World did better than this movie. All the, like when you talk about DVD sales and merchandise sales and all this stuff, merchandise sales tanked big time, because you're talking about, this is not a kid friendly movie. Like, you know, people brought their kids to go and see this movie, and there were many reports of people being upset that they brought their kids to see the movie. And you can sit there and say that they're stupid and have all the non-empathetic things going whatsoever because they didn't look at the rating. People don't usually look at the rating. They look at what came before and they say, this is Batman, Superman, and Wonder Woman, and these are the most iconic characters in comic books, and I want, you know, my teenager to go and see this movie, you know, my you know, preteen to go and see this movie. Whatever, man. Whatever. Whatever your opinion on it is, that's literally your opinion, man. Thank you. But there were people that were upset. And I know myself. They were selling, you know, Batman vs. Superman symbol hats and things like that for kids. I wasn't buying that for any of my kids. Why would I do that? I didn't take them to see the movie. You know what I'm saying? It wasn't kid appropriate. Why do I want them to? No. No, I'm not interested in doing that. And merchandise sales were horrible, including for the toys. Currently, I can go and get those old Batman vs. Superman toys that still haven't sold. They're still on the shelves, you know, in scattered pieces, and they're selling for like $10 Canadian. So, yeah, merchandising sales did not do well at all. I got the Wonder Woman and the Batman one. I didn't even like the way the Superman ones looked. Ugh. I might still consider going to get the Aquaman one, but anyway, yeah, not particularly happy with anything that they did. And I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about Warner Brothers. Warner Brothers is very upset with how poorly Batman vs. Superman did. And that's not just in regular, you know, box office sales. This includes the merchandising. This includes DVD sales. This includes TV deals and things like that upcoming. And when you talk about how much they earned, how much the movie earned, how much Warner Brothers themselves got to keep, and how much in costs had to be expended, Batman vs. Superman earned for Warner Brothers $105 million. Guys, that is exactly $1.1 million more than Ant-Man made. I want to let that sink in for a minute. Ant-Man was a good movie. I loved seeing Ant-Man. I saw Ant-Man twice. You know, so it was surprisingly very good, incredibly endearing. And mind you, I'm just talking about in theaters. Then I went and I watched it again on Netflix. You know what I'm saying? I watched it there. Great movie. It was a really good movie. Michael Pena. Woo! And he also just finally announced that, yes, he is going to be in the Ant-Man and Wasp movie, the sequel. So, yes, very good. Smart move. Good job, MCU. But forget about it, man. Like, Ant-Man is an essentially unknown character. Who knows about Ant-Man? He's not recognizable at all. At all. Not by any measure. All right? He's not recognizable. And it's not even the main Ant-Man, Hank Pym, that they used. You know what I'm saying? He was just in flashbacks. And yet somehow this movie still earned only $1.1 million less. Now, Marvel itself looked at that movie as a failure, all right? Not a big failure, but for them, they looked at it as, this movie didn't make a whole lot of money. So hopefully they can build off of the success of Captain America Civil War and his appearance in there and his giant man thing and whatnot. And hopefully, you know, they can build off of that and make the second movie much better, right? They got the Wasp in it now. Hey, but yeah, they were not happy with that. So how do you think Warner Brothers, who's got the Harry Potter franchises and just all these other incredible movies that come out, more movies and more good movies come out of Warner Brothers than any other production studio out there. And that includes all of Bollywood. So, yeah, how do you think they felt about only making, to number again, $105 million? Because it's not just what they paid the actors and the production costs and the advertisement costs, which were, wow, out of control. That was a lot of money in advertising costs, all right? It helps to explain the first week opening. But to only make $105 million, with all that time being spent, meanwhile, that studio that was being used, they could have had another movie in there that would have made them more money. And Warner Brothers owns DC, but guess what? Warner Brothers owns a lot of properties. So they were not happy with what it made. Now, if anybody's still listening, all the DC fans are like, you know, oh, screw you, Bill. But yeah, when push comes to shove, it wasn't a bad movie, all right? It was a disappointing movie. I was more upset by the fact that this movie should have done so much better. This should have been the hands-down greatest movie that was ever made in the face of creation ever. Ever. Okay? If the second coming happened, I would imagine that it wouldn't have as much of a opening weekend, joking, as Batman vs. Superman had. And it should have had a better second weekend and further. It should have been just the movie of the year because you got the three most iconic characters in the world there. But all things considered, come on, man. Like, it wasn't necessarily a bad movie. It had some of the greatest visual effects ever. They were beautiful, right? I mean, it's Zack Snyder. You know that he doesn't know how to make a movie different than 300, all right? 300 had all those great stop time moments, you know, and slow down time moments and, you know, like bullet time type moments that were revolutionary back when The Matrix came out. By the way, they're going to make a new Matrix movie, and it's apparently going to be a prequel focusing around Morpheus, and Michael B. Jordan is supposed to be in it. And yes, I am excited. I don't care what anybody else says. I'm excited for that. Moving on. So, yeah, boom. You have got, wow. This movie should have been amazing, but it was still using features from back in 300, which I saw it. I drove from Jersey. Actually, I took a public transportation bus and train to get to New York to watch it in the huge IMAX theater there, all right? Because for the very first time, because I knew this was supposed to be an amazing movie, and it was worth it. So totally worth it. But now, we're past that. We are so past that. And Sin City and everything else that this guy's made since, he doesn't know how to evolve past 300, all right? So, yeah, guy, it was nice. It was good in the beginning. Can you maybe go back to film school, something, read a book and look on the internet and see some of the new, go out and see a movie and see some of the new films that are being produced. And maybe you can make a different kind of film. Would that be such a bad thing? Because I don't think it would be. Hopefully Justice League is not going to be like that. The trailer should have just finally released. We had all the little mini trailers up until now. They look great. But let's be realistic. Is there a single person on the face of this planet who didn't think that it was going to look great? Of course it's going to look great. He's got some of the best visuals out there. The problem is, and the reason why this guy needs to have a second director with him that is going to have equal power as him, he doesn't know how to connect those incredible scenes together. You understand what I'm saying? One of the biggest complaints that I have, okay, I'm going to give you an example. Light source just went. One of the best examples I can give you is from Batman vs. Superman. Look, you had that scene where he says, I have to go. There's a problem down in South America. And he flies down to South America. And you don't really get, you get to see really quickly that he saves some people, whatever, okay? And then it goes right into the scene, like it's barely even there. That scene is an afterthought. And then it goes right into him being worshipped, right? And the people reaching out to him and trying to touch him. And they have all the masks on. And it's like the Day of the Dead celebration. And all this crazy stuff going on. If it's Day of the Dead, shouldn't that actually be in Mexico, which is not really South America? Not really. And whatever. So, yeah. Yeah. It was a very beautiful and touching scene where he didn't talk once, and I'm afraid that the scene didn't explain enough, you know? Henry Cavill was seriously robbed in this movie. He is one of the best Superman I've seen. He's my second favorite Superman after Christopher Reeve. You know what I'm saying? He's an amazing Superman. And for him to, I think that the tally was, 14 lines? I could be right, I could be wrong, I don't actually care. 14 lines or so is a travesty for somebody like Henry Cavill to have in a movie that was originally supposed to be slated for Man of Steel 2, which just said that, yes, we're definitely going to do a Man of Steel 2. It's about time. I actually just reported that on the last or the previous podcast, so podcast 12 or 13. Go back and check it out. So, yeah, that movie should have been a whole lot better than it actually was. The problem is that these incredible scenes and amazing visuals weren't connected. Okay? So, like, without those molecular bonds together, it's just gas. It's all just gas. Scientifically, look at that. It's all just gas. Just free form, floating in the air. So, not happy with that at all. They need to get somebody to connect these together. And for the Justice League, guys, you're talking about, you're going to have the origin for Wonder Woman in the Wonder Woman movie, which should come out before, come out before the Justice League movie. And you've already gotten Batman's origin in BVS, which we didn't actually need, did we? A lot of people already know who the Flash is, especially with the success of the TV show. Thank you, Grant Gustin, for that. But they're going to have to give some kind of an origin in there for him. Aquaman is going to need an origin. He's going to need an origin. Okay, just as popular as he is, especially amongst us comic book fans, I'm of the opinion if they screw up Aquaman, we riot. and we riot for real. You know what I'm saying? Like, not real. I'm being facetious. But yeah, I will boycott everything that DC ever puts out again, movie-wise, if Aquaman doesn't come out great. That's all I'm saying, all right? I will kind of fanboy out over a good Aquaman depiction. That being said, they're going to have to give an origin story for Aquaman, because as much as I love him, as much as, you know, he's got this incredible fan base out there, your average person doesn't really know who Aquaman is, except, as Dave Chappelle said, he's the freaking guy who talks to fish. He swims and he talks to fish. What kind of superpower is that? Yeah. Moving on. The thing is, almost nobody knows who Cyborg is. And when they put Cyborg front and center, when that door was coming down and he's right there dead center, this kind of needs to be in a Cyclops origin. Cyclops, did I just say that, really? A Cyborg origin story, like the whole movie. How are they putting out this movie? Now, mind you, Civil War did that. Captain America Civil War was able to do that, all right? Everybody knows who Spider-Man is. You didn't need an origin story for him. They just gave that really quick little recap thing. It wasn't even a recap of the origin story. If you don't know who Spider-Man is by now, I don't know why you went to see any movie. I don't know why you had any interest in seeing a superhero movie at all. Everybody knows Spider-Man's origin, right? The Black Panther's origin, amazing character. One of my all-time favorite characters. I should have worn that shirt today. But, hey, man, like, who knows who Black Panther is, right? Outside of comic book fans, and even amongst comic book fans, not too many people know his origin story, you know? He's just some guy in a black suit. How many people sat there and looked at, you know, him being shot by the helicopter's guns, and it just, all the bullets just, not even bouncing off, but literally just hitting and falling to the ground. Amazing visual. Amazing. And people wondering, why'd they just fall to the ground? Wait, I don't get it. What's his suit made of? It's made of vibranium. Vibranium weave, all right, all throughout. I mean, wow. Just wow, right? And they were able to pull it off. They gave just enough of an origin for us to say, holy crap, and move on without it becoming an origin story. Can they do that with three characters now? With three characters? Because there are going to be people who are going to go and see this movie and they've never watched the Flash TV show, all right? And they've never picked up a Flash comic book before. And there are a lot of Flashes, and they don't all have the same origin story, believe it or not. Seems that way, though, doesn't it? So, whoosh, right there, baby, right there. How are they going to do that for three characters, especially Cyborg, who wasn't made relevant outside of the Teen Titans since before 7 years ago when New 52 started up. He was always in the Teen Titans, and all of a sudden, New 52, it's like, we need a black guy in the Justice League, and we don't want to do Jon Stewart again because, yeah, we're leaning on him too much. Well, we could do Cyborg. Give him promotion. Yeah. Teen Titans versus Justice League. Really good movie. I might have gotten the title reversed, but hey, why don't you come back to Teen Titans? Yeah, no. That was great. Anyway, yeah, so I don't know what they're going to do with that, but they have their work literally cut out for them. The question is, can they cut and paste it, or are they actually going to do something good with it? I honestly don't know, because with Zack Snyder's history of not being able to connect a story and make it good, you know, look, we know that he can. We know that he can. That rescue scene in Man of Steel where he goes and he you know, saves all those people on that oil rigger, the oil platform out at sea, that was, come on, you're going to tell me that wasn't an absolutely amazing scene? Is that really going to be an argument? That was one of the greatest scenes ever. It was amazing. It was cry worthy. All right. And then for him to have a rescue scene where it's just like, oh yeah, there's a ship and he moved it and let me touch you. Like, it turned into a really weird kind of orgy porn scene. It was weird. There was no real connection there. And then he just, what, teleported back home? I mean, like, what was the purpose of that scene? I'm sure that he had a purpose, and we could blame the editors, but are the editors his boss? Because my understanding was that the director tells the editors what to do, and certain things have to be cut, but he could say how it's going to be cut, and I don't know. Like, does Zack Snyder have no pull? Zack Snyder? I don't see that. I don't see that at all. So, yeah, with a little bit of leeway each way, I really just have to look at it as, you know, cutscenes or not, ultimately, it's going to fall on Zack Snyder. And if he were that ticked, he could have said, you know what? You screwed me over in my Batman vs. Superman. All right. So you know what? Screw you. I'm not going to do Justice League. All right. So he could do whatever he wants, right? Anyway, guys, I'm really hoping that Justice League does good. And I'm being straight up. All right. If Justice League doesn't do good, DC superheroes are going to be dropped for a couple of years, maybe 3 to 5 years. All right. At least the whole Justice League franchise. I'm pretty sure it's going to be dropped if it doesn't do a lot better than BVS did. Because my own fan opinions don't matter. You know what matters? That bottom line, that money. That's what matters. That's what they care about. Anyway, guys, stay tuned for Comic Book University's Comic Book Science. And yeah, see you in a minute. Hey guys, Professor Bill, Comic Book University, my totally nerdy getup. You like that? Anyway, so check this out. We got a question, all right? It's keeping Comic Book University's Comic Book Science segment alive for one more week, all right? Now, got a regular on the channel, and he asks, what is it that keeps the hat of Jay Garrick, the original Golden Age Flash, on top of his head while he's running and all that good stuff? All right, first let's look at what's not keeping it on his head. We're going to look at friction, all right? So when he's running and all that air and all that good stuff is hitting him, when he's running at, like, Mach speed,
Yeah, that would cause that head to go, or the hat to go flying off, unless it's got like some serious bobby pins in there holding it together, or some serious Gorilla Glue, double-sided tape. Other than that, inertia. Inertia is the property of matter that allows it to continue in straight motion or to stay inert so that there's some kind of movement, again, in a straight line, while speed was affecting it or not affecting it. So it's basically going to go back to Newton's first law of motion, so that a body at rest will remain at rest and a body in motion will remain in motion until acted upon by an outside force. So his clothes are different because they're actually on him, but the he's, you know, in the clothes, I should say, but the hat is just on him. There's nothing that I know of, no snap. You know, he's not like a Lego. You know those Lego characters, the play school characters, and the hat like snaps on? That's not him. So the only way that I could figure that this would not be the case, that it wouldn't go flying, because, I mean, if he just started running at Mach speed from slow and he wasn't holding on to the rim of his hat, forget about it. It's going to stay back there. And if he's running at Mach 3 and then he just like, you know, comes to a quick stop, that hat's going to keep going at like, yeah, max speed for another six city blocks or so. I don't want to be standing in front of him if he stops short. So here's the deal. The best way to make sure that this actually works in science is to suggest that he has a power to control friction, at least around him, okay, within an inch or two of his body. Now, if he can control friction, let's say absorb the friction or just render it moot, then what happens is it doesn't matter how fast he's running or how quick he stops. It doesn't matter how much wind there is around him. As long as he's able to make it so that the general close aura around him is completely frictionless, then it doesn't matter. Nothing is actually going to change that. Now, the idea of actually picking up the hat, as long as you got a good grip on that hat, you know, maybe two hands, sure. Otherwise, you're not actually going to even be able to get that grip. You know, just like trying to grab onto something. It'd be like holding on to oil-coated Teflon. You know what I'm saying? Just you can't hardly get that grip. So, yeah, that's really the only way that I could think of something like that working, is that he has some kind of power to control or render moot friction. So, yeah, that's pretty much it. All right, back to the other Professor Bell. All right, guys, that's going to do it for this week, podcast number 14. Guys, listen to me on SoundCloud, see me on YouTube, and if you're on YouTube in the first place, don't forget to check out my other videos. I do constant comic book reviews, all the newest stuff coming out. Once in a while, I'll go back and review something from, you know, the age-ye-old comic book past that I just fell in love with, or that really needs some kind of commentary to talk about how funny it was, because, yeah, not all comic book stories are great. They're not all created equally. Anyway, guys, also every Tuesday and Saturday, that's today, I will put out some kind of a character, some kind of Marvel or DC character, maybe something else too, explained in about a minute. I know they're never as low as 1 minute. I think 1 minute, 13 seconds, Plastic Man, my very first one, was the shortest one, but, you know, I try. And sometimes you got a lot of character to develop inside of a character. So Aisha today from Guardians of the Galaxy, all right? She was her, she was Paragon, she was so many different names, Kismet, and she's actually a really cool character. She is kind of related to Adam Warlock, him. So check her out, Aisha, explained in a minute. So that's pretty much all I got. Guys, don't forget to check me out next week. All right, Professor Bell, Comic Book University, class dismissed.